Hi, I'm Ranix, and I'm going to show you how I use Maya. This is recorded live, and it's not scripted properly, so I'm going to edit it later. First of all, I would say if you want to actually learn, you need to try everything yourself and work on an actual project and use all this stuff in an actual project. Otherwise, you're not going to remember it just by watching a video once. I'm going to cover pretty much everything I use in Maya. First, it's basic software settings like autosave. So here you can set autosave. I think it's disabled by default, so that's pretty important. Then the file dialog. The Maya default one is this window, but I prefer the OS native, which is just a normal Windows UI. Then there is the automatically reload updated image files setting right here. So enable that, because when you edit textures, it's going to update automatically in Maya. Unit settings, that's in here. I use meters, that's pretty much it. Camera default planes. This controls when stuff disappears and you're far enough, like so. And if you change units, you probably need to change these as well. And you get really close to stuff. It'll also change. Then about hotkeys. So I use a lot of hotkeys. Most of them are custom, I think. And some of them are as I had them in 3ds Max. So they're changed from the Maya default to something similar to 3ds Max, because that's what I used before. And hotkey editor. So you can change hotkeys, and you can also create custom scripts. The hotkey editor is here, and then there's also the script editor, which is here. And if you enable echo all commands, every time you do something, it'll print out what it's doing. So you can use this to create your own scripts. So the UI. This is the outliner. I have a custom script to change how this works. So by default, it actually works kind of differently. It just shows the objects like this. And if you have multiple objects, it just shows them in a list. But I don't really like that. So I have this custom script where every time I open it, it changes to this view. So it shows the layers. When I open the layers, I can see the objects. Because Maya has this weird stuff where the layers are actually here in this tab, or you can find it here. And I don't like this. I want to see the layers and the objects inside them at the same time. And this is kind of the best way I can find to do this. I'm going to share all the scripts as well. So next is layers visibility. So if you toggle, there's no default layer here, it seems. But let's say if I add this object to the reference layer, it's just a custom layer I've created. You can toggle the visibility, and this thing is called a reference template. So when it's a template, it just shows this wireframe. And when it's a reference, you just can't click it. That's the only difference. And when it's nothing, you can use it as a normal thing. Then there's the HUD, which is this thing. It's here, show HUD. And if you want to customize what's shown there, it's in display, heads up display. And there's like pulley count, view axis is this thing on the bottom. And caps lock, it just shows caps lock is enabled. But yeah, I usually use this just to see the triangle or vertex count. And it also shows the selected object and the selected component. So now about the camera. By pressing space, it changes to this four view. And the one you hover is the one that maximizes by pressing space. And if you hold space and right click, you can change the camera to something else. So most of the camera things are done using holding the Alt key. So Alt, clicking and dragging around is orbiting. Alt and middle click is panning, and Alt right click is zooming, or you can just scroll wheel, but it's more precise if you do Alt and right click. Frame selected. I have this in a custom hotkey, I think. I have it on Z. I think it's default, maybe A or Shift A or something, but basically it just zooms into the selection. If I duplicate this, it will zoom in to whatever I have selected. Next, gonna be some viewport stuff. I think this is a default hotkey. Alt B, you can change the background color. And if you want a custom color, there's this settings, 3D views, background. Change to anything you like. Alt B is those defaults. Usually use this dark gray. Highlight selected. This is a custom hotkey, I think. So when you select an object, it highlights like this, and you can toggle it with... I use F2 for this. But I'm pretty sure it's a script. Selection highlighting, yeah. The script is like this. So I'll share all the scripts if you want them. Most of those are just found in... Either I created them myself using the script editor, or I just found them on some forums and stuff, or just assembled from various scripts together. Wireframe. I'm not sure if this is a script or not. No, it's probably a default. It's this thing. So it toggles the wireframe, and I have it on F3. Oh, it's actually this toggle between these. So. And on F4, I have shaded wireframe. So if I don't have it selected, you can see it toggles this, and I can toggle, but F3 and F4 toggles between these. Flat shade all. This is something I use when texturing. So if I use flat lighting, there's no lighting at all. It all looks flat. So sometimes when I'm texturing UV mapping, I don't want the lighting to distract me. So I disable lighting by enabling use flat lighting. Textured view. So this shows the texture. Right now I don't have any texture, but if I had textures, then with this I could toggle the textures. The grid, I have it on G, and can toggle it here, and here's the settings. So the size of the grid, how many grid lines there are, you can change the colors as well. I use it like this. I have the 8-meter grid because that's for city skylines. So hide and unhide objects. This is also with isolate. So I have hotkeys to hide, and I unhide all. I'm using these hotkeys. They're custom. But I think they're not scripts. Or maybe they are. Oh, unhide all is a script because it doesn't unhide the cameras. Because cameras are actual objects in Maya. So I have them hidden, and I have them in this layer. And isolate selection simply isolates whatever you have selected. And then there's X-ray, just Shift X, so it makes the object transparent. Backface culling. So let's say you have this object, and you can see the faces from both sides. But if you enable backface culling in here, you don't see the other side. And that's how it's usually in game engines, so that's useful. Exposure and gamma. So sometimes for these kinds, I have dark textures, so I just brighten the entire scene here. Like so. Next is about object creation manipulation. So here in create, in polygon primitives, which is what I usually create, it's just like normal meshes. You probably want to enable interactive creation. And then when you hold shift right click, it brings up this menu, and there's all these menus I rarely use because it's not good for my arm to use precise mouse movements. I usually use hotkeys. But for this, shift and right click, and then you can create something. So for example, a cube, and the interactive creation allows you to create it like this with the dragging. And when you create it, here in the channel box, and if you don't have it, it's like somewhere here, there, you can modify these settings. Also, I should mention this history thing. So if you don't have this history here, up here, enabled, you won't be able to modify things like that. For example, if I create a cube, you can't modify anything here. So you need this history enabled. Now if you create a thing, now you can modify these settings. And I would say that you don't want this history for a long time because sometimes it can break the object. And sometimes what happened to me is I would save the scene that was completely fine, and the next time I open it, it's broken and it has something to do with this history. It's really confusing, but for clearing history, I have Control H and it clears all the history. So now it's like an object on its own without any creation history. So these are default hotkeys. QWER, select, move, rotate, scale. I'm pretty sure these are default. So Q is just in selection mode. W is a move. E is a rotate. R is scaling. And if you, for example, move something, then if you hold middle mouse button, you'll repeat that action. You can continue that action. The same is, for example, for scaling. Like if you scale something, and you can middle click anywhere and continue that action. Same for rotation, like so. Tool settings. So for example, if you double click a tool here, these are like, here's the move tool. You can change some settings here. And as an example here, I have negative scale. So let's try the scale. I have prevent negative scale, for example. So this means it won't, well, actually, I'm leaving this in the video because this is just funny. Well, it's supposed to prevent you from scaling in the other direction. As you can see, you can scale it and then it goes in the other direction. This is supposed to prevent that, but I don't know why it doesn't work. Do reset tool. It just doesn't work. Okay. I don't know why. Usually it does work. Actually, let's try it in component mode. Okay, it works here. So I don't know why it doesn't work in object mode, but here you can see that you can't scale it in the other direction. And there's other settings there. So you see this manipulator or gizmo or whatever you want to call it. And if you press plus or minus keys, you can make it larger or smaller. And there's the step snap. So here it is. You can middle click this to toggle it, or you can just choose what you want. So for example, I have 10 here. And now if I move, it will move only in 10 units. So I have meters, so it will move in 10 meter increments. Same is for rotation. So this is 15 degrees and it's limited only to 15 degree steps. If you disable it, you can do it kind of freely. Same for scaling. It's, for example, this is, I think, in percentages. Oh no, it's in like whole number multipliers. Absolute relative transform. So this is up here. You can set it to absolute or relative. For example, if it's on absolute and I set the Y position to zero, the object is now at Y zero, as you can see here as well. But if it's relative, you can increase or decrease the amount. So for example, if I put 5, it will increase the Y to 5 meters, but here it shows in centimeters for some reason. And you can use this for rotation as well. For example, 90 degrees around Y, like that. Next is about the pivot, custom pivot. So for me, it's the F key, but I think default is D key. It's custom pivot. So this is the pivot. And if I press F key, you can align it to some other face or an edge. And now it will be aligned to that. And now I can move it like that. And you can also manipulate the pivot directly, like so. Okay, and next is world, local, object and component and normal pivots. So this is the pivot modes here. So custom pivot is the one that you align here. World pivot is just aligned to the world. Object pivot would be, let's say if I have a rotated object, the object pivot is with the object and world is aligned to the world. So that's the difference. Component pivot is aligned to each component, like a face. So for example, if I select two faces, I have component pivot, it will scale each of them separately on its own center. Snap to grid or snap to point. These are here, but I have them, so V hotkey and X hotkey, I think those are default. So if I have this and I hold X, I can align it to the grid points. And if I hold the V hotkey, I can align it to vertices. And for this, for example, combining that with the custom pivot, I could align the pivot to there and then align that to there. Next is about object display. So this is stuff like face normals, face centers, and hidden triangles. I have these in hotkeys, So face centers will show the face centers like that. And you can even snap to them with holding V. So it's like a snap to point works on these edge centers as well. And hidden triangles is sometimes useful. It's in shift, right click, polygon display, and toggle hidden triangles. So you can see the actual triangulation of objects. This is useful because sometimes you have like a vertex like that, and unless you're in vertex mode, you can't really notice it. But like this, it's very easy to see that there's a vertex here. Next is about materials. So I'm going to set up a material with an alpha map and a normal map. I'm not sure if this is the correct way because it's kind of weird, but I'm going to show you how I do it. So I'm going to find some material I have. So let's say I have this textures. So there's a diffuse, alpha, and normal map. I'll drag them. So this is the material editor. It's called Hypershade. It's here, and I have it on the hotkey M. So in the textures tab, I'm just gonna take these three textures and drag them in. And now I'll select object. I'll just take this face. And I'll just right-click. Well, you have to have the object selected, and then I'll hold right-click and assign textures material to selection. It'll generate the material. Let me just quickly UV map it normally. I'll cover UV mapping later. Okay, here it is on the object. Here's the material. It created the material automatically when I did that. And I'll do graph network. This will show the material here. You hold Alt and the camera settings are the same here. So you see the material graph, there's the diffuse texture, and I'm gonna add the alpha map. And you have to middle click to drag in Maya. And here's the alpha texture. And if I assign this to transparency, you can see that it's actually inverted. So to invert it, you need a reverse node. And then you plug the color in that, and then transparency there. And now it's the correct way around. But another thing that you need for alpha maps and normal maps is you need to ignore this file rules and set the color space to raw, because it's not sRGB, it's linear, which is raw. So that changes how it looks. You can even see that. It's very difficult to see, but you can see that raw looks different. It's more correct, but it's not completely correct as far as I can understand. I don't know why, but the actual middle point still isn't 128 RGB, where it transitions from visible to not visible. So what I do is I just put 0.4 in the exposure, and that's about right. I don't understand why, but that's how it seems to work. Okay, next we'll do the normal map. I'll drag the normal map here. And for the normal map, you need a bump node. It's a bump 2D. And this time you need to use the alpha instead of the color for some reason. And you plug that into the bump. And in bump, you just change it to tangent space normals because it's a tangent space normal map. And you drag this normal into the normal camera. And now this... Oh, I forgot about the color space. So for the normal map, you also need to ignore CS file rules and raw color space. And now it's not so easy to see, but maybe you can see that it has a normal map and see how the lighting changes. So that's how I set up materials for preview in Maya. I actually don't render in Maya, so I only make assets for games. So that's how I use it. So there's different alpha modes. And that is in render and viewport settings. You can see there's transparency algorithm. And if I make multiple of these, like so, there's object sorting, simple, there's alpha cut. Alpha cut is completely sharp, which is what I usually use. And depth peeling allows for kind of semi-transparency. So you can see it's very smooth compared to alpha cut. And those are the two that I usually would use, depending on what I'm making. And also for texture resolution, you probably want to disable clamp texture resolution, because if you have really huge textures, it will reduce the resolution. Or you can just set it to a really high number and do that. And sometimes I like to replace my diffuse texture with just gray, so I can see the normal map better. And the way I do that is I take the diffuse texture and I move this color gain way down, so it's completely black. And then color offset, I raise to like somewhere here, and now it's gray. So now it's easier to see the normal map. And when I want it back, I just color gain max, color offset zero, and now it's back to normal. Okay, next is going to be the modeling section, which is, the biggest section. So let's first start with all the selection modes. By default, Maya has selection modes up here, I think with F8 and all these keys, but I prefer them as they were in 3ds Max, which is 1, 2, 3, 4. Actually, 4 is different because UVs are handled differently in Maya, but so 1 is a vertex selection for me. 2 is edge, and 3 is face. So it's these are the modes here. You can see in the modeling toolkit. If you don't have it, it's like here. So vertices are vertices, edges are edges, faces are faces. And I can quickly swap between them. And you can also, for example, if you select a face, and if you hold Control and then click that other type, or I can just press Ctrl-1, it will convert the face selection to a vertex selection. So if I have selected the face and I want the vertices, I can just Ctrl-1. Or if I want edges, Ctrl-2. And other way around as well, if I select a vertex, Ctrl-3 will select the connected faces. And same goes to edges, so you can kind of convert selections like that. If you want to add to the selection, you hold the Shift key. So you can see, when I hold Shift, it's the plus sign appears. When I hold Control, the minus sign appears. And if I hold Control Shift, you'll always be plusing. So for example, if you have a selection like this and you shift drag select, it will invert the selection if it selected something that was already selected. But if you want to only add to the selection, for example, I have this face and I want to select all the others, I need to hold Control Shift, then I can drag select and it will add everything to the selection and it won't flip the selection as it was with the shift. And you can also use the tab key. If you hold the tab key, you see this changes here. So you can do it like that. And you can also drag select. I'm going to add some more faces. So now you can see you can drag select and drag deselect as well. Tab by holding the tab key. You can invert the selection. I think this is by default Control I. That's nothing special. Just invert the selection. You can also shrink and grow the selection. So most selection stuff is under Control right click, but I have it on hotkeys, but you can say you can grow. And you can grow and shrink the selection. And by holding tab, you can also select from a vertex to vertex. For example, like this, if I have this vertex, and I want to select all vertices from here to there, I can just tab and double click on that other one. Same goes for edges. If I want from this edge to that edge, I can just tab, double click this, and it will select everything in between. Same goes for faces. Like that. And you can also select a loop of polygons. Let's add more subdivisions. So let's say I want to select a loop in this direction, like around the entire thing. I can just click this and then hold tab and double click the next one. And we'll select a loop like that all around. I'll disable these hidden triangles. There's also a thing called contiguous selection. So if you have an edge selected, if you go to Control to Edges, to Contiguous Edges, it will try to select edges that are kind of in the same line. If they're too different like these, it won't select them. Next is Use Constraints. So this is in Select, Use Constraints. And I would select all the next. And for example, you can select only inside faces. Those are faces that are not on the outside. So for example, these faces have the borders. So they have an end, their end somewhere. So select that. And there's other ways to select specific things. For example, by orientation, you can select only faces that are facing upwards. So they're facing Y1. So Y is the up axis, or you could select faces facing the X direction. And there's other stuff like that here. You could select a random amount of faces. And when you quit this, I would do close and reset. So it forgets the settings you did. Soft selection. So soft selection is here. If you enable it, and you can change the angle, and you can see the visual representation of the soft selection. And what it does, it allows transform something in kind of a soft way. So without soft selection, you're just moving that face, and with soft selection, you're moving that and everything around it based on the distance around it. Move scale components with edge or surface constraints. So these are transform constraints. So right now I can move this vertex in every single direction. But if I enable edge slide, for example, it will only be able to slide along the edges it's on. So it's restricted. And for the surface, it can only stay on that surface, so it can't move outwards or away from it. Same for faces. So for example, edge slide, and you see that it snaps to the edges around it. And that's also useful if you have organic shapes. For example, I have this edge, enable edge slide. I actually have these on a hotkeys as well. And you can slide on that edge or that. And you can't really move it away from that. Same for vertices. So next is extrude tool. Now you can extrude by holding shift and just dragging like this. Or you can use the extrude tool, make sure the history is enabled. And you can extrude and you can change the settings here. And if there, for example, if this is changing too slowly, you can change this circle, change things quicker or slower. And you can also use it for insetting. So no thickness, just insetting a face like that. It's not actually extruded. Next is bevel. So let's create some shape here. I'll select an edge and make sure history is enabled and bevel. So that just bevels an edge like that. And it's very fast right now. So I'm going to click that circle. And now it's going to be slower. And there's other settings, like if you disable chamfer, it will just add loops to it like that. If you have multiple segments, the depth will change the curvature, like so. Next is bridge. So let's say that I have two faces like that. And I want to bridge them. So there's an option called bridge, and it just bridge them. But you could use it in other cases as well. Let's say you have a triangle like this, a cylinder like this. And let's say you want to connect all these. Let's say you don't have that. And you want to connect all these to these, you can bridge. And you can see it's like, looks kind of weird. So you can change the bridge offset. As you can see, that changes how it decides to connect them. And this is correct. So connect it like that. Next is wedge tool. So wedge tool is useful for creating some kind of pipes or vents. I'll show you how it works. I need to show the multi-component selection for that as well. So let's say that I want, don't look at this face, just look at this face. Let's say I want something like, to create something like this, but I want to create it perfectly instead of freeforming like that. And the way to do that is using the wedge tool. You need to use multi-component selection. So you need to select this face, and then you need to select some kind of an edge around which it will wedge. So, and now shift right-click and wedge. And we need in the other direction. I'll do minus 90 and how many divisions you want. And this is useful for vents or pipes and stuff like that. So it will wedge it around the selected edge. And you can do this with the cylinders as well. I just need an edge somewhere. I'm going to use that edge. So if I have this cylinder like this, and I go to multi-component selection, select that edge, wedge, and same kind of idea. Next is the poke. So poke will just take a face, shift right-click, and poke. And it will create a vertex in the middle, like that. So if you need to create a kind of a pyramid shape quickly from a face, you can do poke and it will do that. Duplicate faces. So I have it on Control D. You can do Shift right click, duplicate face, and now you can move it and it's duplicated. You can do multiple at the same time as well. I have it on Control D, so I usually just Control D, then go back to, let's say, the move tool and move them. And then I have this quick rotate script. As I said, I will share all the scripts so you can use them, but I have quick rotate 90 degrees. And this just takes my selection and it quickly will rotate around the Y axis, so 90 degrees. So it's easier to see. I can rotate like that quickly. And same kind of idea for flipping. I have shortcuts to flip on every single axis. So flip Y, X, Z. And there's just scripts. So if I have my selection and I want to flip it on the, say, X axis, I just have Shift R like that. And Y axis, I can flip like that. And Z axis like that. So those are scripts I use. And I have it on the R. So Control R, Shift R, Alt R. So now multi-cut. Let's see. So multi-cut is here. And you can just cut it across like this. But you can also click on vertices and cut the model like that. Or you can cut along edges like that as well. And you do the cuts, and then once you're done, just enter and it will cut. And if you hold Control and Shift, you'll have some options. So say I'm holding Control and Shift and I can cut on 90 degrees. And there's another, you can cut, so 90 degrees like this, but also 90 degrees when it connects to the next edge. So you can cut 90 degree stuff like that as well. And also there's a planar cut. So for example, if I want to cut everything along here, along a plane, go in multi-cut, and here you can slice along plane. So I want to cut it on XY plane. Now let's do XY. And now there's like this face, plane that you can move. It'll cut everything along that plane. So I can also vertex snap it, for example, like this. Now snapping to a lot of stuff because I have a lot of stuff here. Yeah, you can cut along a plane. And when you go back to move tool, let's say, it's now cut there. Next is connect. So I'll create a new shape. So if I select an edge like that, and for example, shift click that, it selected a ring of them. So it selected all four around. And the connect tool, you can cut it multiple times like that. You can slide it to somewhere as well. Slide it to one side like that. And you can also pinch it. So kind of push it outwards or push it inwards like that. And once you change these, you can shift control and middle click, yeah. So shift, control, middle click, you can change whatever you last changed. And if you go to shift, control, right click, you can change what you want to change. So for example, pinch, now shift, control, and middle click like that. And I want to change the segments, also do that. So I have it on shift C, and the ring selection, I have it on K. The way you do that is control, right click. There was edge ring utilities to edge ring. Now it selects an edge ring and now shift C. I have connect and I can connect it like so. So remove, you can remove vertices and edges, but there's different ways to do it. For example, if I select this loop by double clicking it, you can see has vertices on it. And if I press backspace, it will disappear. But actually, the vertices still are there. So let's go back. If I select this, and now I do Control Backspace, it will also delete the vertices. And you can also delete vertices on their own if they are not connected to multiple things. So for example, this vertex, and I just backspace, and it removes it. Now it's just one face, just one edge like that. Okay, next is break. Let's say I have these faces, like so, and I want to break this face off. And the way you do that is shift right click, and there's detach components. And now it's detached, but it doesn't always work. So for example, if I have faces like this, which are connected by one vertex, and if I do shift detach, it actually won't detach. So you need to select this vertex, and then you need to do detach components on that vertex. Now they are separated. So it doesn't always break it off properly, but I have it on Control B. So I have this face, I do Control B, and so detach components. Circularize, okay, let's do that. So let's say I have this ball, and I want to make it circular. I do shift right click and circularize components and makes a circle. And it doesn't need to be a hole exactly. Like if it wasn't a hole, it would still work. For example, let's select these here. Shift right click, circularize, also works. Chamfer vertices. So if you have a vertex like that, you can bevel it as well. I don't know why I have this as a separate point, but yeah, you can do that. And you can even do that on here, like so. Cut the corner like that. Weld merge. So I have these two vertices, and I can do merge vertices to center, like that. And another thing I can do, let's break this apart. And if I have these, as you can see, they are separated, but they're really close. I do merge vertices and enter the threshold, so how close they need to be merged. And if they are close enough, you can just move this up. As you can see, it merged them. Detach and combine. So I have custom scripts for this, I think. I think combination doesn't require a script, but detach does. So detach is the script. I don't know where I found it, and I don't remember if I edited it. But yeah. So if I select edges like faces like these, I just do D, now it's a separated object. And for some reason in Maya, it's really messy. Like the combination and separation of objects seems always kind of weird. So that's why I found that script. There's other scripts online, I think. And once they're detached, I can combine them. But I think the way I combine them, so mesh combine. So if I have these two meshes, I can just do combine and it combines them. But as you can see, it creates all this garbage in the outliner. So you need to select it and clear the history. Where it actually is delete all by type history. But I just have it on a shortcut. So I select it and Control H. And that's how I delete history. And it deletes all those weird objects it created. Next is snap together tool. So let's create an object, like a little cylinder, like this. And let's say I want the cylinder to perfectly align on this face. And the way you can do that is the snap together tool. So in modify, snap align objects. Oh, it's a snap together tool. Okay. Here, and you select on the first one and the second one and enter. And it aligns it like so. Next is transform component. So let's say I want to take all these edges and expand all the edges outwards. So the object kind of extrudes, not extrudes, but every face moves outwards. The way you do that is edit mesh, transform. And now you have this new gizmo. And if you move that blue axis, it will do that. And you can change the value specifically in this channel box. As you can see, it's the local translate. So for example, you want to move it outwards like 2 centimeters. You can just do that, like that. And as always, I would clear history after it's done. And next is lattice FFD. So let's say I'll create something quickly. Okay, let's say I have this object and I want it to fit perfectly in this space, but I'm not sure how I would do it. Like scaling like this would be kind of imprecise. I want some kind of a box just to stretch this object exactly to fit that space. And that's what the FFD will do. So it's in deform and lattice. And you can press the box to have options. I just have 2 subdivisions everywhere. I do create. And you see this box appeared. And if I hold control and right click the background and then do lattice point, now I can select the points of this box and I can scale the object like this, squish it and stuff. So I can just use snapping and I can stretch it to fit that gap. And now I select the object, control H, clear history, and now it fits. So I have another script, which is called fill hole with quads. So for example, if I have a hole like this, and I just select the edges around it, I have this shortcut, Ctrl-Shift-Alt-Q, which will fill the hole and make it into quads. You can also do it manually by Shift-Right-Click fill hole. And if you select the face, then you do Shift-Right-Click, you can quadrangulate or triangulate. For example, you can triangulate like that, and then you can quadrangulate. And now it's mostly for quads. Next is edge flow. So let me make something here. For example, if you have this smooth shape, and you have this one edge kind of in a weird spot, you can shift right click and do edit edge flow, and it will try to follow the curvature it should be. Like so. If I move this somewhere else and do edit edge flow, it will move it into a nice place for the curve. And there's the hard and soft edges. So if I select all this and go to mesh display, I can do harden edge. As you can see, all the edges are hard right now. There's no smoothing. And for example, if I select these edges and I do display soften edge, now all these on the top are smooth. Let's do the same here. Soften edge. So that's how that works. And you can flip normals. That's reverse. So now this face is reversed. And if I enable backface scaling, you can see you can't see it from that side. You can see it from the other side. So you can flip faces like that. I have it on shortcut N. Next is average normals. Let's see. So let's say I have this weird face and I want it to be kind of smooth, but all together facing in the same direction. So I can do average normals. If I apply, now it's all trying to face in the same direction. This is sometimes useful when you have like low poly geometry and it has like weird smoothing issues. That might help. Next is set normal. I'm gonna create a little thing for this and I'll bevel this edge like that. Let's say I want this to appear like a smooth corner, but if I make this smooth, then it will smooth also these edges on the bottom, as you can see. I'll create an even better example. So now I take this, and if I smooth it, I want only the corners to be smooth, but right now it's like the entire face is smooth, and that's not what I want right now. So the way what I would do here is, first of all, I would set it to all the hard edges. And then I would select, for example, these vertices. And I would do set vertex normal. And so x direction is here. So I would do negative x direction. Apply. And for these here, I would do negative z direction. As you can see now, these faces look flat on the sides, but this face now appears smooth. And if I enable vertex normal edit tool, these vertex normals, you can see, are facing on this face, they're facing that way. And on this face, they're facing that way. So now this corner looks smooth, even though it's just a single face. And this can be useful in some situations when you want a rounded looking corner like that, but you don't want to add more geometry. This is useful. Vertex color display. So vertex colors and vertex paint can be useful for some stuff. In City Skylines, it's used for some shaders. So here you can enable toggle display colors. And now you can't really see anything, but if you do apply color, let's say I apply this vertex color. Now this changes the vertex color and you can set like each vertex to something else. And this is used for some shaders to control some stuff like movement in the wind and stuff like that. I haven't used it that much, but sometimes it's needed. Next is preserve UVs. So let's disable the vertex color. Let's take this thing that has a texture on it. So let's say I want to move this edge like that, but I don't want the texture to squish. I want the edge to kind of just slide along and the textures to stay in place. So for that, you use preserve UVs. You can enable it here. And if you move, you can see that the UVs are preserved. Unlike it would be normally like this. But like this, you can almost like an image crop. And I have a hotkey for this because it's separate for every tool, like move, rotate, and scale. So I have the hotkey, which toggles it for all the tools. So normally I move like this. And if I enable preserve UVs, I can move like this. So next section is going to be UVs. So I have this mouse hotkey to open the UV editor. I have it on Control E, and I think it's also a custom script UV editor toggle. Yeah, it's a custom script, so you can I can open it and close it, and it also switches to UV toolkit here and then back to modeling toolkit once I close it like that. So that's how I open the UV editor. And so if you wanted to open it manually, it's like somewhere here. I already forget where it is because it's here, and you can probably use some other way to open it, but I use this. So first is image ratio. So usually, originally, you can see this texture. This texture is kind of stretched. And you can change that in image ratio. So it shows the actual ratio of the image, and it's also a button here. And here you can select which of the material textures it's showing. So diffuse, alpha, normal, those are the textures that my material has. So it shows them like that. You can also dim the texture. So that's easier to see with this toggle. You can also toggle the grid here, and you can change the image range. So for example, if the image range is just 0 to 1, it shows it only once. But if I set the range to cover a lot of styles, so 50 in each direction, it will show it 50 times in each direction. You can also toggle the pixelation filter. So for example, it shows blurry like this. And if you do image unfiltered, you can toggle between pixelated view and filtered view. And it's also a button here. And also the Z, so it's just frame selected, also works in UV. So if you have a selection like outside of view, you can zoom into it like that. Okay, let's see some ways to create UV mapping. If I select all these faces, I can do create automatic. So there's just automatic UV mapping. That's sometimes a good starting point. And you can change a bunch of settings here. I'm not gonna go into it, but the original would be like this. This is not great, but it might be useful for a starting point. And for example, let's select this loop of edges around it. And there's a specific cylindrical projection. And you just click that, and now it projects the cylinder. And you can enable the checker pattern so you can see how it looks. Break off shell. So let's disable that. I have it on Alt-Q, but let's open all this stuff. If I select some edges and I want to break them off, you need to do create UV shell like that. And I do Alt-Q, and I can just break off piece like this. And you can move a specific amount. So let's say you want to move an entire tile. Move your selection an entire tile. You can use this, or you can move it like 10% of a tile. You can do precise movements here, also precise rotation and scale. For example, I want to scale only on you, like that. There's also flip here. You can flip horizontally or vertically. And just like for the model, you can use a lattice deformer. So for example, if you wanted to scale this, let's say to fit exactly this tile, it would be kind of messy to try to align it and scale it the way you want. But if you do tools lattice, now there's this red frame around it. If you click on an edge, you can move each edge separately. And you can snap here as well. So for example, X, you can grid snap. You can do that. And I have it on Shift T. So I can just scale it like this. And it's pretty handy to scale from each edge. It's like a free transform in Photoshop. Get and set density. So let's say I have these, I have these faces like this, and one of them is like way smaller. So the texel density is very different than these. So if I do texel density get, for example, I want them all to be as small as that one. So I select these, I select it, I get the texel density, and now I select other faces, and now I can set the texel density, and it scales them to be the same texel density. So now unfolding, let's do a selection, let's say do a camera based. So I have this, have this really messy UV mapping, as you can see, it's completely screwed up. And I'll just break a single edge. So now they're not connected on that edge. And if I do unfold, it will unfold. So it's like, now it's completely nice without any stretching and stuff. And you can also do something like only unfold on one axis, unfold along U or unfold along V. Will not do anything right now, but let's say I move it like this. And if I unfold along U, it'll only change in the horizontal direction, won't change vertically. So this is useful, for example, if you have UV mapping that is screwed up like this, and you don't want to move it vertically, but only horizontally, just do unfold along U. And the same goes for V direction. Next is straighten UVs. So let's say you have something like this, which is slightly not straight. You can just select the entire thing and straighten UVs and straighten them. Next is break. Break is similar to shell to create UV shell, but it breaks every single face separately. So example, if I select these three faces, I break them. As you can see, it's all separated. And that is, actually don't know where it is. It might be just carried over from something else. It's called split UV. So that's what I have. I didn't actually see it anywhere. Yeah, I'm not sure where it actually appears. Next is normalize. So for example, you have, let's move this away. Let's say you have this, and you want to scale this perfectly on the tile automatically. You just do tools, you just do modify and normalize, and now it takes up the entire tile exactly. Then there's weld and merge. So let's say I have these two are separated, and I just move it as close as possible here to that. Okay, I select these, which are very close together, and I do merge. Okay, I just needed the higher threshold. So they are close together, and then they are merged together, and now they are welded. So I have these custom scripts for distributing and aligning UVs. So for example, if I have this and I select these UVs and do Shift W, it will scale them to zero vertically. And if I do Shift A, that for me is, so it puts them together like that. And distribute, let's straighten all this. Unfold along U. Let's say that I have moved them around or stuff. And I have this distribute. So distribute U, and it will equally distribute them horizontally. Next is linear align. So let's say I have these faces, and instead of just, let's say like this, instead of moving all them to the center like that, you want all of these to come up here. So you can do the align. So here it's the align, and you can align to the top. Now it takes the topmost and puts everything that high. And you can do the same for the bottom like that. And there's also linear align. And what that does is, let's say you have a bunch of vertices in random positions, and you select them and do linear align, and it will put all of them in a line like that. Then there's snapping. It's the same as snapping in the normal 3D modeling. So X, you can snap to the grid. And with V, you can snap to vertices like that. Or UVs. Orient. Orient will try to orient the shell kind of vertically or horizontally. If you have multiple of them, it will try to align all of them. You can also do stack. I'll show you what stack does. If you have them like this, and let's say they're kind of rotated. And if I select all of them and do stack and orient, we'll try to put them all kind of straight and in the same spot. And you can also do unstack to put them next to each other, but unstacked. Then there's gather. So what gather does, it takes everything and puts it, let's put it lower. If I select everything and do gather shells, it will put all of them in, it will try to put all of them in the main tile. So they're not outside. But some things it can't because they're crossing the tile line. So if I quickly do automatic and I just move some of these to different tiles like that and then do gather, we'll put all of them together, back together in the main tile. Then there's randomize. So let's say you have all these UVs together like this, and you would like them to randomly distribute them, let's say vertically. So you can there's the randomize shells option. And if you shift click it, you can choose on which axis and what's the maximum amount it should move. So this sounds fine to me. So I'll just close it and do randomize shells, and it will randomly move them vertically in that amount. And you can do it multiple times if it's not random enough, like that. Layout. So layout will take all the shells and put them together somehow in the main tile, like that. And you can shift click it, and you can change, for example, the padding. Padding is here, for example, that. You can see it's less padding. If I do that, it'll be more padding. And there's other options you can change. Next is UV snapshot. So for example, let's say these are the UVs of your object, and you want to create an image from this. So you can go to image, UV snapshot, choose the resolution you want. I'll do 1K. And I'll put it in this folder. PNG. You can change which tiles you want to in the image. And you just apply it. And now it is here. And you can use this image to start your texturing, for example. And it will only UV snapshot the selected stuff. So you only want some specific stuff. You can select that and do add an overwrite file, and that's the new image. Okay, next is LOD baking. So let's say I'll open one of my models because it already has an LOD mesh. So for example, I have this. And I'll fix the textures here. So let's say I have this model. Let's brighten up the scene so it's easier to see. So let's say this is my LOD mesh. This is my main mesh. Ignore those weird rectangles because it has alpha map. Anyway, let's say you want to bake the LOD from this texture. So I have this LOD. It's UV mapped all in the main tile like this. And I'll just put it over it like this. And I'll change this mode to rendering. And then go to lighting, transfer maps. So the source mesh is the main mesh. So let's take the main mesh, add it as the source. And the LOD is going to be my target. And let's see, preview the cage, or it's called here an envelope. So how far it covers the main mesh, like that. And you can bake normal maps or displacement maps and stuff. I only need the diffuse right now. So just diffuse. So choose a folder for it. I don't need that. You can change the resolution. I think world space is fine. This is the quality. I usually keep it on lowest, at least for the first test. Fill texture seams will fill the area around, so it's not immediately transparent. It will kind of extend the texture. And advanced options, usually just leave them on default. And geometry normals and surface normals, if it's like more of a organic curved model, I think geometry normals is better. And surface normals is better for something super straight angled and stuff. So anyway, I'll do bake. And now let's check that image. And here it is baked. So as you can see that this fill texture seams option extends the texture beyond the UV edges, so it fills in the background. And that's my baked LOD. I usually would bake in a higher resolution, like way higher resolution, and then I would just scale it down. Okay, next is exporting. So for example, let's say you want to export this for the game. You have to make sure the pivot is in the right spot. So this thing, like you should move it in the spot that it should be, like where the actual pivot should be. So for me, it's just 0, 0 here. And if you have done any scaling or rotation to the object, you should do modify and freeze transformations. So that when you export your object, it doesn't lose all the scaling or rotation that you have done. Okay, so this is my object I'm going to export. I use this game exporter. And you can set different settings here. It will probably be different for other games. But I have just smoothing groups, tangents and binormals, and split vertex normals. I don't use smoothing. Triangulation doesn't matter, I guess. And so here for exporting, you can move to origin, which is just it moves the object to 0, 0, because sometimes you need that. Sometimes it, if you move the object somewhere else, it will actually import in the game also somewhere else. So maybe you want it to be in 0, 0 if it's not. Animation, I haven't done any animation ever, so I don't know. And up axis, for these commands, it's Y axis and Y as well. I usually use 2012 FBX because that works for City Skylines. But it might be different for something you do. And then just have a folder. And you can export selection. So you could select like multiple meshes and export them all at once. And that's correct. So I'll just do export. And in the folder, now it's exported here. So it's nice that you can select a lot of meshes and export them all at once because you can use export selection. And I have a script for this, which simply does the export, and I just need to click yes for replacement, and it does it. So I can I'll share the script, of course. It's this script. It opens the exporter and does the exporting. But you need to set up all these settings beforehand. So first time you export, you set the settings, and then you can use that script or on a hotkey or something like that. And the last thing I want to mention is this play blast. So sometimes you want a really high resolution screenshot of the viewport. And the way you can do that is in Windows, play blast settings. So this can also render videos, I guess, but I don't deal with animation, so I don't know about that. I just do image, PNG. You can choose like a folder where you want it. And you can set like a very high resolution here and just do apply. And it really lags if it's a high resolution. And it did something, and the image should be there now. And there it is. It's a super high resolution image of your viewport. That's kind of useful sometimes for screenshots and stuff. And yeah, I have covered pretty much every single thing how I use Maya. Just as an extra thing, I can show you my mouse setup. So I have the G703, and in here you can create like these macros. And I have one for UV editor, reset pivot, and quick export. So if I go to the mouse and do Maya default assignments, yeah, here I can see, like, I can set all these macros. This software is pretty bad. I don't like it. So I can't edit the macro here. I guess I need to go back to Maya, say reset pivot, and here I can edit macros. That's pretty useful. But other than that, I think I covered everything. So I hope it's like helpful or something. And if you want the hotkeys, they're always in this website. And this drive folder has some random Maya stuff, but it also has the scripts in here. So if you open one of these files, the scripts are in there. That's pretty much it. I can't think of anything else. So I hope it's helpful. Okay, bye.